Let's go ahead and get into the Prometheus movie Exposed. Now, this source article that I'm citing from was not a Christian source article. So I ended up editing quite a bit. I really, not so much editing, but just getting rid of a lot of the material. A lot of it was his wild theories. I just wanted to kind of stick to more of the facts of the movie and what the movie was about, and then analyze it from that point, from a biblical standpoint. But the actual source article was, I believe, Prometheus' Fire, Alien Gods, and Pandora's Box of Tricks. In the recent movie Prometheus, directed and produced by the father of film, Ridley Scott, he's known as, quote, the father of film, we find many connections to literature and common themes that talk of creator gods descending to the earth in the ancient world. Now, if you look at the actual source roots of intelligent design, and you really trace it back, and you just don't look at take a cursory look of intelligent design, it actually believes in this ancient astronaut theory, which is what Prometheus teaches as its core, source, how the movie starts out, essentially, that a creator god race came to planet Earth and seeded humanity in one way, shape, or form. Now, there's a lot of different varying ways that may be presented. If you go up to YouTube and you can Mission from Mars and can Last Scene, well, that's one of the ways it's presented. Where, in that particular case, this large gray alien with this feminine motif, which was really kind of creepy, presents to the space astronaut guy, this is how you were created. And essentially, you know, they had to abandon Mars a long, long time ago. And then as they were abandoning Mars, they chucked a few, seed pod things onto planet Earth when it was, you know, 80 billion gazillion years ago. See, if they can get you to believe it was that long ago, well, anything could have happened in 80 bazillion gazillion years. I mean, hey, you know, that's why they do it. I don't believe in that. I don't believe, and I know there's going to be people that oh no, the Earth is that old. I just believe in the creation account, you know, which we're not looking at near that long of a period. I believe God can create something with the appearance of it looking ultra old as well. So a lot of this is very subtle, and intelligent design is even more subtle because, oh, we have a common creator. But like in the last scene of Mission from Mars, essentially they seed the planet, and, you know, they're dropping their little whatever seed pods into the ocean, and then it shows like them actually transforming into like a whatever, you saw an amoeba into a minnow, into a fish, into some type of salamander type creature that ends up crawling on shore, and then that evolves into everything else, and then, you know, obviously eventually to the ape, to the Piltdown Man, or whatever. So that's their form of evolution. You can actually combine intelligent design, ancient astronaut, which is really the same thing, and Darwinism into one. They can find a way to skew it, to make that all work. It's all garbage and lies. It's all total garbage and lies. You can't create life out of essentially nothing and have that evolve into what we are today. It's just the most asinine thing. And again, I don't have time to get into a study on evolution. That would literally, you could do a 100-part study on that easily. And there's people that are absolutely devoted to that. So we got all that same dynamic going on. So you can have the evolutionary theory, Darwinism. The story commences in the distant past when a spacecraft with an advanced humanoid alien species, these genetic engineers, arrive on Earth. The alien engineer consumes a dark liquid, causing his body to disintegrate and fall into a nearby waterfall, hinting at the seeding of new life on Earth symbolically. No, it's not symbolically. It's literally, you know. The essence of life in this way is visually conveyed quite graphically as infectious codes, which are the building blocks of life passing through the blood and the DNA of all life on Earth. Later in the movie, we witness the impact of meddling scientists that go to the place of origin and enter an alien chamber on a distant moon or planet. They get to this planet, and it's, I don't know, some planet that I think looks like Saturn, and supposedly there were all these cave writings they found in these ancient caves around the world, and they all said, okay, these are where our creators are from, essentially. So, you know, they get this brilliant idea to get into a rock and go there and meet our creators is essentially the whole thing there. I mean, and it'd be one thing if they went there and, you know, they were this noble race of space giants that were waiting for us to finally get there. I mean, no, that's not exactly the reception they get. What they get is pure evil. So, I mean, even Hollywood, you know, they're trying to tell you something here. You know? So, going further, ancient stories from all over the world talk of the gods, giants, and titans both fighting and ruling over humanity. Now, the legend of Prometheus is the one that tells of this titan deciding that he would disobey the gods and make humans gods themselves. Oh, our benevolent creator. Oh, what a fun guy. According to Greek mythology, Prometheus belonged to the older order of gods, the titans, and was from the bloodline of Lapidus, also, which is also a moon on Saturn. Now Saturn, sixth planet from the sun, six letters in its name. Six. If you change a couple of words around in Saturn, it's easy to get the word Satan, something pretty close to it. Yeah. Weird. Anyway, he was from the bloodline of Lapidus, which also is also a moon in the sun, and Uranus. His legend tells of stealing fire from Zeus and giving it to humanity. The fire Prometheus stole was said to be the very essence of life, and this light that was literally life itself. So I guess by his ultimate sacrifice of, in this particular case, the way the movie presented it, was of drinking the substance and then killing himself, seeding the planet for all life as we know it, including human life. So I really guess we owe my big dad the gratitude. Anyway, just teasing. Anyway, in Greek mythology, Prometheus is a creator god, and his actions were considered both rebellious and symbolic of the spirit of the fallen one. Lucifer is also noted as the bringer of light. Now, I've done many, many teachings on this particular subject. I post a whole bunch of them right here. The statue of Prometheus that stands outside the General Electric Building and overlooking the ice ring at Rockefeller Center, Rockefeller, in New York, was crafted by the heavily connected Paul Howard Manship. And it epitomizes the elite as gods on Earth today. See, the elite believe they've already achieved this godhood status. And then we're like their serfs, their little slaves, and most of us don't really have any right to live because they know better. And this is a big reason they want to kill, you know, 90-95% of us off, according to the Georgia Guidestones, which is their first commandment of their 10 commandments for the New World Order, which says reduce population to 500 million, which would be, you know, between 90-95% reduction. See, they're the real gods. And they know what's best. The Rockefellers, like the Rothschilds, are families that see themselves as this bloodline royalty connected with these counterfeit gods of the movie Prometheus. See, if you talk about, you know, there's no shortage of ego here. You talk about, you know, somebody that's beyond delusional. The General Electric Building, which there's a little picture here above, also celebrates Saturn, the father of the Titans. Imagine that, Satan, father of the Titans, named Urizen by William Blake in his image of the same design called the Ancient of Days. So they view Satan as their supreme creator god, which is, he's over them, sure. He's the anointed cherub that covereth, as the Bible referred to him before he fell, when his name was Lucifer, essentially. And then it changed into Satan, essentially, after he fell. They view, and they're correct, because he is at the head of their food chain, the satanic food chain. Now, for more about Satan, a.k.a., or Saturn, I'm sorry, Saturn, a.k.a. Satan, see my teaching called The Hexagram, all of the attributes given to the mysterious Caucasian blue-eyed bearded gods of the prehistoric world were attributed to the many false savior gods that would emerge much later in places like Mesoamerica, which would be Quetzalcoatl, Phoenicia, which would be Baal or Baal, Babylon, Tammuz, Rome, Mithra. All of these, quote, gods were considered the masters of time. The alien genetic engineers in Ridley Scott's movie are giants, and of course, time travelers. And Scott's work would have been loosely inspired by the ancient knowledge of the gods found all over the world. So there's some pictures of some screenshots of the movie. The film unfolds in the spaceship Prometheus in 2093, arriving in the orbit around the moon. The moon is LV-223, after passing a planet that looks like Saturn, hence the connection to Saturn's moon, Prometheus, and the moon that they eventually land on, LV-223. The reasoning behind the mission is, as the head of scientist Shaw states, the matching star maps found on various artifacts are an invitation of right. Yeah, an invitation to hell. With the increase in the transhumanism and cyborg technology, it was no shock that Scott chose to incorporate an android within the plot as well. In the movie, his name is David, who stays awake at the pilot control to monitor their voyage. Later in the movie, the android carries out his own sinister agenda, which hints at the danger of transhumanism. I think he kind of wanted to be like a real human. He was pursuing his own thing to accomplish that. It's hard to say. In the movie, David's command of the ancient languages and his ability to read hieroglyphs allows him to unlock the star maps coded by the recent alien engineers. On a more serious note, the connections to a technology obsessed transhuman agenda today could leave us all plugged in to a robotic reality, which again is Satan's ultimate plan. Holograms are being used more than ever. But Peter Weiland, the elder founder and CEO of Weiland Corporation, funds the creation of the scientific deep space research that becomes the Prometheus mission. The Weiland Corporation in the movie is everything the global elite are today. Peter Weiland, in his TED speech, says, quote, "We can create cybernetic individuals. We are the gods now." He also says, from the Titan Prometheus, we received our first piece of true technology, fire. The Illuminati bloodlines are the kings of biotech, nanotechnology, and nuclear fission, and the movie hints at this through the very elite Weiland Corporation. The elite are doing all of this now through genetic engineering of crops, DNA databases, test tube species, brave new worlds, and mutant robotic life forms. You name it, they're doing it. Now, of course, Ridley Scott's films, The Ancient Species, The Alien Species, is a hybrid predator that is born of a combination of alien genetic engineers. The gods in the movie Prometheus and the albino reptilian species are called Hamerpedes that resemble the facehuggers in Scott's earlier alien movies. The one-eyed symbolism comes up again and again in the movie, and not at least connects to the one-eyed south pole of Saturn. Now, Saturn has a south pole, and it looks like an eye from outer space. And it's like, there's a lot of really, really creepy stuff with Saturn. Okay? Big time. Okay, so, yeah. And there's actually a picture here of the south pole of Saturn if you want to see it. It'll be on page 5 or 6 of the PDF. And it's an actual picture of the South Pole of Saturn. So, And again, they all always have this one-eyed symbology. You look at the back of a $1 bill, you know, the all-knowing eye of Lucifer or Horus at the top of the capstone. So, the interesting connections visually for me are that there seems to be a common theme of reptilian-like aliens converging with human alien god species.